Hi class, welcome again to another session on Rehabilitation Engineering. So today we shall discuss augmentative communication. So first of all, we know what communication is, right? So communication is transmission of an information from a source to a destination. So now that source can be a speaker, that source can be an audio recording, that source can be a video recording, anything. Right, so any information that is carried, the mode of communication of an information is called as, or the mode of transmission of an information from one source to another is called as communication. Right, so why do we require augmentative communication? So it is basically for people who cannot communicate independently, or who verbal communication is impaired in these people. So the messages are designed to communicate an information to a place, to either place a request or to like answer a question, right? So either you present some information to another person or you request something. So these are two broad classification of how communication works. So the messages are developed based on augmentative communication. Messages are developed based on the age, the cognitive and social capabilities, and the lifestyle. So based on age and lifestyle, the requirement to either request or or transmit an information differs. Also, the cognitive and social capabilities of an individual should also be taken into consideration while designing an augmentative device. So for example, if there's an old person, right, and so their interest would totally be different from a youngster, right? So for example, in India, if you see that our grandparents are usually very spiritual people, so the most of the communication that occurs with them is about spirituality, whereas youngsters, they like to discuss stuff like cricket or other, in thing like movies, etc. So you don't see your grannies, sitting and discussing movies of, the recent era, right? So therefore, their requirement, their augmentative communication requirements is totally different of an, say, for the augmentative communication requirement of an 80-year-old would probably be much different from an augmentative communication requirements of a 20-year-old. That's why you have to take into consideration the age, the lifestyle, and the cognitive and social capabilities. Now, individuals who cannot speak often use a special electronic device that processes the incoming speech, stores and transmits it. So this is this can either be a text-to-speech converter, or this can be a speech enhancer, depending upon what kind of communication issue the individual has. So the selection of aids also depends upon the level of disability. Now, general forms of communications are, basically communication. If you want to develop a communication device, first of all, you need a source, right, or the input, and then the electronics that would process the input, and the output. Output could be an environment, output could be a fellow individual, output could also be an audience, or, it could be an audio recording. So, in case of speech impairment, the user is the input, the environment, and the environment is the output. So the person who is talking to someone is that someone becomes the environment. The person who is talking is the input, and the device that is processing the speech is the electronics. Right? For people with speech impairment, there are two types of communicator media available. So one is a vocate communication, and the second one is the autocom. So vocate is mainly used for communicating in hospital environment, right? So it has simple vocabulary like, please or no thank you, yes please, or yes I have, or okay, and these kind of words, right? So which you'd use in a hospital setting. For example, if you're going in, going and seeing the consultant, then the consultant might ask you, how are you doing? So you might want to answer, very well thank you, right? So you press a key that would say very well thank you in a very clear and precise voice. Also, the individual might ask, or the doctor might ask, do you have certain symptoms? So you want to answer in yes and no. So you have a key for yes and you have a key for no. So based on whatever your answer is, you just press that particular key and the system, the OKID system, would communicate what you want to say, right? AutoCom, on the other hand, is a computer-based direct selection device that can be customized to meet the user's specific demands. So it is not just about the hospital environment, it can also be in the general like day-to-day activity communication that a person needs to do, right? So AutoCom is more a user on a day-to-day basis communication aid for the user, and OKID is mainly for hospital setting or communicating in yes and no and all. So OKID is very basic, AutoCom is slightly advanced. So another concept is the deafblindness. So these are the deafblind people are the ones who have both visual and hearing impairment. So often rehabilitation of such patients is very, very difficult because they have issues with communication as well as development. So the person can neither see nor hear. So it's a very tricky situation to be, and as a rehabilitation therapist, you want rehabilitation therapy works only when the patient understands what the therapist is trying to say. So here, if it is visual as well as hearing impairment, it is very, very hard to figure out whether the patient has understood what you are saying or not. So also these patients, they face challenges in their education and their day-to-day activities as well. So because of this like visual and hearing impairment, not only will they have learning and physical disabilities, which can along with their visual and hearing impairment, these patients can also have learning and physical disability. So physical learning disability, which is very well understood, because it's very hard to learn something when you can't hear or see it, right? And physical disability because we saw in balance training that your vestibular apparatus plays an important role in balancing, right? So if you're not able to hear properly, if you're not able to perceive properly, it is hard to balance. At the same time, try standing in one position with your eyes closed, you'll find it very, very difficult to balance. You think that you're going to fall off, you have vertigo like symptoms. If you stand in one particular position, you just stand in a particular position erect with your eyes closed, it is very difficult to do that. So in blind people as well as deaf people, the deaf and blind people, it is very, very tough to have that physical stability. So I mean, some people might be stable enough, but some people might have physical disability as well. So it depends upon the individual to individual. So for such patients, early education must concentrate on multisensory approach, because they can't hear, they can't see. So touch is one of the major sense organs that is used to educate these people, that is used to give them training, right? Touch also as well as smell. So these two sense organs are primarily used to educate such patients. Communication and language are based on these two sense organs, and that should be taught in a meaningful manner. Then body contact and self-awareness should also be developed in such patients. Also, major requirement is that the parents should actively participate along with the patient. If the parents do not cooperate, then the rehabilitation therapy will not be successful at all. Key success to rehabilitation therapy is the support of the parents or the carers. So for such patients, during early education, the support of the parent is vital. I think I've spoken enough about these kind of impairments. We shall discuss more hearing and visual impairment devices in the next video. I hope you take care till then.